Hello, and welcome to our video for the 2nd of August. We hope that you enjoy the contents. There'll be the usual songs, readings, prayers, and communion. So if you don't have your bread and wine handy, you might want to nip away quickly and get that. But don't forget to pause the video so you don't miss anything. Our theme for this video is lifelong learning and what that might mean for us as followers of Jesus. Our contributors today are from within the fellowship and they're all involved in education, either receiving it for themselves at school or university, or giving it as teachers and lecturers and pupil support. We hope that you will enjoy what's shared, but more importantly, we'll hope that you will be challenged by the messages of Jesus and how he wants us to be followers of him and what that might mean for us and how that might look. But let's pray as we start.
Shall we pray? Father God, Creator God, we wonder at how great you are. We praise you for the beauty we see around us in your creation. We praise you for your great love for us. We praise you that we are fearfully and wonderfully made. As the psalmist says, your works are wonderful. We know that full well. Father God, you made us all and you love us all. You gave us Jesus, your Son, our Saviour. You watch over and protect us. You care for us all. You hold us in the palm of your almighty hand and we give you praise. We thank you that you created us in your own image and you gave us the capacity to be lifelong learners, to experience the delights of learning and discovering new things about you and the world we live in. You made us able to be creative, artistic and musical. You created us to be encouraging, to be nurturing and to show compassion. We thank you for the people in our lives that you have given us to teach us new things and help us learn new skills. People perhaps from school or church or our families who have worked with us and shown us patience and guided us and encouraged us until we found success. We thank you for places of learning worldwide. We thank you for the education system we have in this country. We thank you that through the development of technologies, education was able to continue, albeit differently through this challenging period of lockdown, that contact and connections were maintained with pupils, and whilst extremely challenging at times, successes were achieved. We thank you that we can lift to you any who felt lost or overwhelmed by the demands placed upon them. As we look ahead to schools returning later this month, we thank you that behind the scenes, the COVID Education Recovery Group, local education authorities, teaching unions and others are working together to draw up plans to try to ensure that this return to educational buildings can be as safe for all as is possible. We lift them up to you and ask you to grant them wisdom as they work. We pray that you would prepare staff and pupils for coming back into their places of teaching and learning. Father God, we all need you. Forgive us for not always calling to you in times of trouble or for trying to manage without you. Forgive us for not living by your rules but by our own or in our own strength. We ask you to meet with us now today. Strengthen our faith. Challenge our thinking, increase our trust in you. Help us to learn from you, our great teacher. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Jesus, we adore you. can a young person stay on the path of purity? By living according to your word. I seek you with all my heart. Do not let me stray from your commands. I have hidden your word in my heart that I might not sin against you. Praise be to you, Lord. Teach me your decrees. With my lips, I recount all the laws that come from your mouth. I rejoice in following your statutes as one rejoices in great riches. I meditate in your precepts and consider your ways. I delight in your decrees and I will not neglect your word.
The Great Commission. Then the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain where Jesus had told them to go. When they saw him, they worshipped him, but some doubted. Then Jesus came to them and said, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I am with you always, to the very end of the age." May the Lord bless this reading from his word.
Second Timothy chapter 3 verse 16. All scripture is God-breathed and is useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting and training in righteousness.
It's hard to believe that in just over a week, the schools will be going back after the summer holidays. I know that this year the holidays have been shortened, but even still, it seems like they've gone by very quickly. Although I must admit, I'm quite excited at the fact that at the moment, schools are going back full time after the first week of adjustment. One of the things that I had to do last term was homeschooling of Iona, because like the rest of society, her school had gone into lockdown and the kids were at home. Iona's teachers were very good at sending out email work each week with lots of activities to do, too much to do. And I was also very fortunate that Iona loves doing her schoolwork, and so it wasn't a problem on the whole to get her to knuckle down and do her work. We even set up a desk for her in the back bedroom, which she could use. However, she did in time graduate to the dining room table beside me. I don't know if I did a very good job of homeschooling, but I do know that very often Iona referred to me as the grumpy homeschool teacher. Lots of us have had to learn new things since lockdown began. I took the time to update my food hygiene certificate. Thankfully, that wasn't a particularly difficult thing to do. And I was able to do that online and scored reasonably well, all things considered. And it's a handy thing to have, just in case. Many of us have had to grapple with technology that we had never dreamed or thought of using in the past. Video calling software, getting used to emails and things like that, watching YouTube videos, learning how to put videos onto Facebook, how to organise email posts and the like. It's been a steep learning curve for many of us, but it's brought great satisfaction when we've achieved something that we never thought possible. And as we continue with church life remotely at the moment, perhaps more of us will grapple with new aspects of technology. Another great thing that I did was the Baptist Union of Great Britain put up YouTube videos every day by Dr. Helen Painter, one of the tutors at Bristol Bible College. For the first 70-odd days of lockdown, she posted a new video for the next instalment of the Bible. I was going to say it was a video per book, but some books required more than one video and other books were bunched in together. But it was a fascinating snapshot of what the Bible is all about, giving the big picture. And I really enjoyed watching that and learning from it, picking up on things that I'd never picked up on before in my reading of the Bible and studying of the scripture. If you've got time, it's well worth dipping into. I've also been dipping into lunchtime conversations weekly organised by the Baptist Union of Scotland, where ministers gather and chat, discuss, tease out what ministry looks like for us at the moment. We've tackled subjects like, can you really do communion? over the internet. What about mission in the post-COVID era? What will church look like? Racism and other big topics like that. And it's been fun just to bat around and hear what other people are thinking. It introduced me to a new word that I'd never heard before, and I'll say more about that later. One of the things it did remind me of, and all these things have reminded me of, is that we need to be lifelong learners. It's the way that we've been created. There are always new things to discover, new ideas to come across, new nuggets to deepen our faith. We need to keep on learning. Last month in our video, we were exploring Jesus' observation that the harvest was plentiful, but the workers are few. It was at the end of Matthew 9, and we read into the beginning of Matthew 10, where Jesus sent out his 12 disciples to go and to pick the harvest. It was in effect their on-the-job training. Jesus had taught them. They'd listened to him preaching the Sermon on the Mount. They'd heard him telling parables to the crowds and to themselves. He'd invested his teaching in their lives. And now it was time to put that teaching into practice. But he'd also shown them what it meant to belong to God's kingdom. He'd performed miracles in their presence. He'd shown them what human interaction really looks like. They'd seen him in action, and now it was their turn to put what they'd seen into practice. Peter, Andrew, James, John may have thought that they'd learnt all they needed to know about fishing and that was them for the rest of their lives, but no, they had to learn what it meant to be fishers of men. Matthew had been a tax collector, and maybe he thought that that was all he ever had to learn and know. But no. Jesus was teaching him new things. There were new lessons for him to learn. And this was true for all 12 of the disciples as they sought to live as followers of Jesus. They had to learn. They had to listen to Jesus. They had to watch him in action. But they also had to do it for themselves. The new word that I learnt is a word called andragogy. It basically means adult learning, as opposed to pedagogy, which means child learning. Andragogy is about lifelong, self-directed learning. It's about never giving up and never thinking you've learnt everything you need to. We're told that for learning to be effective, it needs to be motivated. It needs to involve doing. It needs to involve problem solving. It should draw on our personal experiences. It should be informal. And we should be equal partners in it. It's the kind of learning that Jesus wants of us. He wants us to be motivated as we seek to learn of him and from God, as we delve into the Bible for ourselves and discover new things that we'd never noticed before. It will motivate us to delve deeper, further, to not give up learning. But as Jesus taught his disciples, it's not just about head knowledge, it's about doing as well. And if we're going to be effective learners, what we learn will be put into practice. Through the prayer course and the Talking Jesus course that have just finished, we've been learning about prayer and sharing our faith with others. That learning can't stop at watching the videos and having been involved in discussion together. It needs to be put into practice. It needs to be done. Some of the different ways and ideas of prayer need to be practiced. Some of the ideas about sharing our faith with others and sharing God's story with those around us need to be shared. Effective learning involves problem solving. One of the great things I've enjoyed doing are the puzzles within the weekly emails on a Thursday. it's been great fun seeing some of the answers that people have come up with, some of the struggles that we've had, because we know that as we solve problems, what it is that we're solving goes much deeper into us. It's much more meaningful. It's much more important. We've invested something in it, so we will hold on to it. There are many problems in our world. None of them have easy answers. But as we seek to grow and deepen our faith, we'll do it through the solving of problems. We'll do it because we want to find the answers. We won't just accept the easy answers. We won't just accept saying, I don't know. We'll go and search and discover for ourselves the answers to the problems that we're facing or the questions that people are raising up around us. Our learning's effective also when it draws upon the experiences we've had. All of us have experience of God at work in our lives. All of us have experience of having read the Bible and discovered things for ourselves. All of us have experiences that will help us to learn new things, rediscover old things that we'd forgotten. Great learning is also informal. We've had to do learning differently while we've been in lockdown. Some of us have struggled with the idea of using video, of doing things remotely. But it has changed how we learn. And hopefully, some of it for the better. It's expanded the way that we can do things. It's changed how we view things. Our learning can be informal. Our learning is also effective if we're equal partners. In schools nowadays, teaching is very different. Many of us would hardly recognise it from our school days. One of the great things is that children are encouraged to learn for themselves, to take ownership of what they're learning. And that should be true for adults as well. We should be equal partners. We should be willing to learn. It's not just all about the deacons and the minister spoon-feeding us. We have a responsibility ourselves to learn, to be involved. We're to be lifelong learners. We can't rest on what we've known from the past, because there's always new things to discover about God, about our faith, about how we apply our faith in our world today. When Jesus sent out the 12, he sent them out to teach and to show what God's kingdom looks like. And Jesus is asking the same of us today. We're to share God with those around us, in our words and in our actions, as we seek to be lifelong learners, motivated, active, problem solving, drawing on the experiences that we have of God, and seeking to learn in new ways. As we continue to go through phase 3, and church can't operate the way that it normally does, what are we going to learn? What are we going to put into practice? What new discoveries will we have? And who are we going to share them with? May we all seek to be lifelong learners, lifelong followers of Jesus, because that's what he's called us to do and to be, and that's who he's called us to make.
Lord God, we give you thanks for the privilege of being able to come into the presence of the Creator of the universe and the giver of the gift of all our lives. That you are at once the infinite and eternal God, and yet we can call you our Father, is beyond our human comprehension. Lord, we live in such strange times, and there is so much to bring before you that it is hard to know where to start. We pray for our world as it faces this global pandemic, one of the biggest crises in the history of our world. We give you thanks for all the health workers and care workers around the globe, working at the sharp end of the pandemic. We pray that you would give them strength and courage to continue their self-sacrificing efforts to care for the victims of the virus as they make every effort to restore them to health. We pray especially for our own National Health Service and for those who work within it, the doctors, the nurses, the porters, the lab technicians, the administrators, and all the rest. We pray for the researchers, the scientists, who are pulling out all the stops in an effort to find a vaccine. We pray, Lord, that they may soon be successful. We pray also for our political leaders, that you might impart wisdom to them as they attempt to navigate their way through this crisis. We pray that our politicians may be guided more by the moral and ethical demands of the situation rather than by any political expediency. We pray in particular that at this time, as we are coming to the end of the school holidays, that wise judgments may be made with regard to the reopening of schools. Lord, closer to home, as a fellowship, we are mourning the loss of folk close to many of us. Lord, we pray that you may comfort those who mourn the loss of loved ones. We ask that you would make yourself known to them in a very special way and reassure them that though we grieve for them now, they are with you and we will see them again. Make the hope of resurrection a reality in the hearts and minds of those who mourn. We pray also for those folk we know who are suffering from various ailments and illnesses at the moment. We would ask that you would be close to them and reassure them also of your love. We ask all these things in the name of our Lord Jesus. Amen.
Come to me, all you that are weary and carrying heavy burdens, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. Come to this simple meal, not because you must, but because you may. Not because you are strong, but because you are weak. Come, not because any goodness of your own gives you a right to come, but because you need mercy and help. Come, because you love the Lord a little and would like to love him more. Come, because he loved you and gave himself for you. Come and meet the risen Christ, for we are his body. Let's pray. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Apostle Paul tells of the institution of the Lord's Supper. For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this, whenever you drink it, in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." Let's give thanks. Loving God, we praise and thank you for your love shown to us in Jesus Christ. We thank you for his life and ministry, announcing the good news of your kingdom and demonstrating its power in the lifting of the downtrodden and the healing of the sick and the loving of the loveless. We thank you for his sacrificial death upon the cross, for the redemption of the world, and for your raising him to life again as a foretaste of the glory we shall share. We give you thanks for this bread and wine, symbols of our world and signs of your transforming love. Send your Holy Spirit, we pray, that we may be renewed into the likeness of Jesus Christ and formed into his body. This we pray in his name and for his sake. Amen. Jesus said, "This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in memory of me." Take this in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your heart by faith and with thanksgiving. In the same way, he took the cup after supper and said, "This cup is the new covenant sealed by my blood. Whenever you drink it, do this in memory of me." Drink this and remember that Christ's blood was shed for you, and be thankful. Your death, O Lord, we commemorate. Your resurrection, we confess. Your final coming, we wait. Glory be to you, O Christ our Lord. Let's pause for a moment of silence while we remember others that are dear to us, who are on our minds and in our hearts at this time.
Father of all, we give you thanks and praise that when we were still far off, you met us in your Son and brought us home. Dying and living, he declared your love, gave us grace and opened the gate of glory. May we who share Christ's body live his risen life. May we who drink his cup bring life to others. May we whom the Spirit lights give light to the world. Keep us firm in the hope you have set before us, so that we and all your children shall be free and the whole earth live to praise your name through Christ our Lord. Amen.
My strength, my song, this cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are stilled, when striving cease. My comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ I stand. In Christ alone, who took on flesh, fullness of God in helpless babe, this gift of love and righteousness, scorned by the ones he came to save. Till on that cross as Jesus died, the wrath of God was satisfied. For every sin on him was laid, here in the death of Christ I live. Light of the world by darkness slain, then bursting forth in glorious day, up from the grave he rose again. And as he stands in victory, since curse has lost its grip on me, just blood.
As we draw this video to a close, if you've been watching this at 11 o'clock on Sunday the 2nd of August, there's an opportunity for a virtual coffee time over Zoom. The details are in the email. And even if you don't have a web camera, you can dial into the Zoom call where you can hear what's being shared, even if you can't see. So please do join us for a chance to catch up and to see and hear each other. But before we do that, let's close by sharing with the grace. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen.